G'day guys, welcome to Peeex Fishing. You're with Craig Connolly, and it's been a while since I've made a video. We've had the COVID-19 lockdown, of course, and then I got sort of very, very busy with my business over that time, and it hasn't sort of let up, unfortunately. But anyway, I've got the I got a half day booked tomorrow. I was going to head out tomorrow with the guys from the club. They're heading out to the Moats, which will be a really exciting trip. So if any of you guys are watching, I apologise. I would love to come with you, but I just have to be back in Auckland to see a client, unfortunately. But there you go. So I've got a couple of things to show you. One is here. We've got the new Eski on the back of the ski. And this has been designed by Dallas Corp. And there's a bit of a story behind this. I was complaining to Dallas about my back. I damaged my back when I was younger. So lifting heavy Eskis with, fishing it, etc., just is, I find on the ski, just seems to always keep triggering things in my back. So this thing is made out of material. It will hold ice for a day and a night, I believe. So the next day you can fill up the fish in the morning, which is what I always do. I sort of worked out these other Eskis hold ice 5 days, but you just don't need that on the ski, you know, so it's a bit of overkill, too much weight. And this thing is very, very light, but durable, and it's made out of very, very durable heavy-duty gear that he uses. And we've got a little drainage hole there, one on either side. I've got good storage here with a zipper, and I've got some, you know, I've got all my bits and pieces in there. This is actually, just to show you how strong these things are, there's a lot of weight in there, as you can see, and I can quite happily chuck it on there, you know, no problems at all. So, you know, they're not made out of solid plastic, but they are very, very durable. So inside, that's what it looks like inside, and very tough material. So it just clips on there, as you can see. There's another clip that go onto the FXHO little ones there. So that's where it's being held on. The same on the other side there. And then we've got another clip that goes underneath the Yamaha thing there. So this is I think will be the ideal setup for me. So I've got my stainless rod holders here. I can hold 4 rods. Got another one there, another on the other side. So plenty of room for the rods. The Eski's not too much in the way. If I need to get on the back of the ski, I could actually collapse it with my body weight if I really need to. So I think it's got quite a lot going for it. I'll be interested to see what other people think, and I'm going to test it out in the morning and see how we go. So I've got a couple of historical things to show you tomorrow as well that you I think you'll find interesting. But I'm off now, hit the sack, get a good night's sleep, be up nice and early, and I'll see you in the morning. Good morning, Auckland. We're far away, well, it's looking pretty nice. There's no wind. Looks like we're in for a few squalls of rain, which is not a problem. Don't mind the rain, just the wind is the fisherman's enemy, and it looks like there's going to be not much wind today. It's looking pretty special. Incoming tide, and how many are at the ramp? Can't see any cars. I might be the first. Well, this is Buckland's Beach, and quite a beautiful spot, but this was the spot where in the 1800s, or late 1800s at least, if you want to get into Auckland from this side of town, or get over to Rangitoto or Motutapu, which was the sort of destination for beach goers to go and relax, then this was where you caught the ferry. It was just up here, just further up the beach there, where the ferry used to come. There's a big wharf, and people would come down there and they'd go into Auckland to do work, or they'd go into Motutapu for the weekend with their families to picnic and do all those sorts of things. So yeah, quite a historic place, Buckland's Beach, very significant to Auckland in the late 1890s and early 1900s. So I'm heading out towards my favourite fishing spot, which is the Noisies, which is here. And there's Otata Island there. And I normally fish sort of around this area here or over here. Just have a bit of a hunt around. The guys that have been doing really well lately have been out wide. So they've been right out off Cowow and sort of out at the Fingers, which is this area here. And then also halfway between Omaha and Little Barrier. Apparently there's been some pretty big workups there and such like. So big fish out there. Long way to go. I had to be back for a meeting in Auckland, but it was a really tough day's fishing, and I met a lot of guys who had actually caught, you know, fish, very, very small fish, and they didn't keep any fish at all to take home. So it was a tough day, but the trick out at this area and the Noisies, when it's a tough day, is fish the bite times. That's a good lesson. Look at the bite times, fish those, and change out your lures. So as it turned out yesterday, the guys that were doing really well out wide were catching on very dark lures, red and black. And I didn't have any of those with me, but I tried quite a few lures, didn't get a touch. And then I did find the one that was doing the business. So let's go and have a look at that now. So we're out at my favourite spot, the old Noisies, right beside Takatū Reef. Or Takapu Reef, actually, it's called. Yep. So you can barely feel, this is actually quite a good fish, you can barely feel them. Really, such a light. That was just the slightest nudge. So they're not aggressive on these lures, but these ones certainly work. And that's with no sign on the sounder, so I'll show you what the sounder looks like. It's completely barren. So it just shows you sometimes there are fish down there. And this one will be a keeper. It'll be the first fish to go into my new Eski, which is looking pretty good down there. I'm picking this guy, he's going to be about 37. Yeah, good eating fish. Gonna be happy with that. Gotta be happy with that. First fish of the day. My lure today, this is actually a smoky shad, and this one is made by Strike King, and it's also identical to the Z-Man. So I think they were made in the same factory at one stage. But this one, so if you're looking to buy these, you can just get the Z-Man ones, they're exactly the same. And I've got some of my favourite ones, which is a Gulp New Pennies. However, I was reading the other day, some guys were saying they're doing really well on these. So always worth a try. And I've got a little bit of the old secret sauce there. It should be lurking around here somewhere. There it is. Oh, this is wonderful, having a big pocket like that on the Eski. It's just fabulous. Dallas, if you're watching, mate, I'm loving it. So if you're interested in one of these Eskis, Dallas Corp is your man. So it's Dallas and C-O-R-P. You can see him on Facebook pretty easily. He's pretty active on the jet ski group. Close it up. Yeah, still no sign.
Yeah, I think he'll be a bit small, this little fella. See him. He is...
No, he's about 34. I'll let him go. He's a bit small.
He's a bit small.
Little boy. Hang
on. Oh, he's off. Yeah. Oh, god damn it. Big two. Yeah, got him. This will be a keeper. He's 34. I'll let him go. Yeah. This is a better fish. Right on the drop. Right on the drop. Oh, it's a good fish. Oh, yeah. Swordfish Steve, if you're watching me, I need to come and get the new bearing for this reel. She's a bit worn out. Everyone around me, there was about 8 boats around me, they've all moved. They didn't have the patience to stick it out at the beloved Takapu Rock. Yeah, it's a good eating fish. It's a good eater. Beautiful. I'll get a measure on him. Keep still, mate. He is about 45. Yeah, that's a good size. Not too big that it doesn't spoil the eating qualities of it.
Well, that's about it. I just had a guy come up from the jet ski community. He's been out wide. He struggled out there and had another couple of guys come in. I think they were out towards Tiree and out in that Cowell line, and they got a couple of panties out in sort of 50 meters. So yeah, I think it's just been, you know, it's one of those days. It's a little bit of a tough day, but I got 4 fish, so I'm happy with that. And that'll sort of keep me out of mischief for a while. So I'm going to actually head home now. But on the way home, I want to take you to a very, very special place. And it sort of ties in with what we were talking about before with the Buckland's Beach. So I'll take you there and I'll explain all when I get there. Well, this is the first spot, and this is actually on Otata Island, right beside, you know, where I fish. Now, check out how clear the water is here. Look at that. It is like crystal clear, absolutely beautiful. So here is a picture of where I am, and you can see it's right on the end of the point of Otata, and you can see Takapu Rock there as well. So one thing that sort of was interesting, how big the shoreline was. When I looked at it from afar, it looked like it was flat. It was actually very, very tall. But anyway, let's go and have a wander around there.
I don't really think this anchor's going to hold too well, but we'll give it a go. Right, let's see if this is going to hold. Here we go. Oh, I think it's going to hold. I'll take you over the hill and have a quick look anyway. Lots of shells here. This might have been a midden at one stage. And this is like a little isthmus. There's some oyster catchers over there. So that's Rakino Island here. And we're just at the point. The anchor seems to be holding beautifully, actually. So we'll keep going for an explore. And just around here there's a house. I think this is where the house is. It? Pretty sure this is it. Or it might be the next bay actually. Yeah, I think the house is the next bay around. So. Right, goodbye Otata Island. Very beautiful. There's a little gap just between these rocks. There's a rock comes right out to there, but if you go around about here, where is it? I can't see it. I think right in the middle of them, there's plenty of room. It's about 3 meters. Lovely. Okay, there's that a big cave here. I'm pretty sure that one goes the whole way through, but I could be mistaken. But you can imagine when the easterlies, we get a lot of easterly flow in Auckland, easterly storms, and you can imagine the easterlies, which is here, coming in here for, you know, hundreds, thousands of years or whatever it's been, and that's what's made those caves. But yeah, lovely spot. Right, let's go out of here. Guys, welcome to Home Bay at Motutapu. And this is a fascinating place. There's a lot of history here. There is over 300 Māori pās alone, so it's got a big history with the Māori people that lived here for many, many years. And when Rangitoto exploded or erupted next door, there are some footprints here of a man with a dog running through hot lava to escape. Very popular in the late 1800s and early 1900s with Aucklanders coming out by ferry from Half Moon Bay. And there is a speech that occurred in early 1900s. So there is a beautiful home there called the Reed Homestead. It was built in the early 1900s, and it was the three brothers that lived there. I think the youngest one lived with his wife, and this is where they are buried. And you can walk up the hill with stunning views from there. So fascinating place. So let's go and take a look at the house.
Because the ski keeps pushing back in. So this is going to be very, very quick. Reed House. Reed Homestead, built in the 1860s. Check out the sea wall here. They obviously get a lot of weather, and I might be going to rescue the ski. There's a little seat there you can sit. That's the warden's thing here, but this is beautiful. This is Home Bay.
Motutapu, and it is an absolutely beautiful place. We're just going to go and rescue the ski.
So what I'm looking at here is there is a huge drum type thing on the beach, very rusty, and behind it is a quite a large concrete structure. And I did a bit of research today and spoke to one of the ladies from the Restoration Trust, and she believed it is a boiler, and it might have been from a whaling station. But she suggested I keep investigating to see what else I could find out about it. But primarily, it is pretty big when you get down there to have a look at it. Yeah, so if you know what that is, or you've got any history about that, I'd be really interested to know. So comment below what you think it is. It might be from World War II. It could be from the whaling days. It could be something used to generate power. I really don't know, but it is quite a large structure. Someone will know something about it. And there also looks like there's a foundation there for a wharf, but I couldn't find anything out about that as well. But anyway, hey, what I'm going to do now is head off, and I've got a little bit of Kahawai footage coming up shortly. So on the way home, I found some birds working. I got a Kahawai. So if you want to stick around and watch that, by all means. If not, hey, thanks for watching. Really do appreciate you watching the channel, and any comments or feedback, always good to hear them. So sorry the fishing wasn't sort of lightning hot, but yeah, I got 4 fish, so I'm happy with that. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching. I'll see you next week.
There's fish right under us. It's got to be Kahawai. All right, let's have a drop straight down. Oh yeah. That's the sounder. So, if that's not Kahawai, I'll be... surprised. Oh, they're having a go at it, whatever they are. That's about all they're doing. Alright, we'll get it right down to the bottom, see what happens. Yeah. Oh, just about. Whoa, there we go. There we go. Big Kahawai. We are fast approaching some rocks here. So I need to get this guy in. Get the old gaff ready. The Kahawai circles. Here he comes. He's not run out of fight just yet.